Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to our service, broadcasting to you from our dining room on this very blustery morning. but there is a real sense of the winds of change being around, I think. Yesterday morning, if you tuned in to morning prayer, we broadcast that from the Lady Chapel for the first time for quite a while, as Gordon as incumbent is now allowed to enter the building, and I can tag along with him as part of the household. There's a sense of change in the air. And of course, we're going to be continuing in our readings from Acts today, times of change for the church, times of change for the church all round. Before we go into our worship, just one or two or even three notices up on the screen there. Keep in touch. You know how when you go into a room with other people there, you've got that radar going, haven't you, where you're thinking who's here, who's not. Oh, so-and-so looks really well, so-and-so looks a bit preoccupied. I'd like to tell so-and-so something else. I wonder what's happening with somebody, another person. Well, all of that radar that we do, the clergy do in spades, and the clergy radar is struggling a bit at the moment because it does need to have your feedback. So Jill sent out round robins. Do feel free to respond to those, even if you think, oh, I haven't got much to say, but if I was chatting to Jill at the door, I would tell her this or give her my idea about that. Pop that on an email, send it in. One-liner emails are fine. They're shorter to read, but do keep in touch so we've got a feel for how everybody is, the things we need to know, and the things it would help us to think about, and how you are. There's a little second bit there about online giving. Obviously, the church building is still here, the staff are still here, lots is still happening, even though we're all in our homes. So if you do feel able to continue giving to support that, we would be delighted if you're able to give online or a cheque to Ellesmere Port PCC to keep that continuity of giving going, given that we can't send Adrian and Helen around to knock on your door with the collection plate this morning. And finally, stay for coffee. It's been working really nicely after the service to have the line still open for us to chat and to exchange our news then as well. So there'll be some music playing afterwards with our own singers on them, and enjoy that and sharing some news as well. So we're going to prepare for worship now, and rather than launch straight in, let's just take a moment to settle ourselves. So I'm going to encourage you, just where you are, just to close your eyes and to take three slow, deep breaths, just to land here this morning. And as you do that, the palms of your hands, just rest them on your lap with your palms facing down, as a way of letting go of all distractions that are not just outside but also within. Our minds can bounce around like pinball machines, can't they, from one thing to another. I hope the washing machine doesn't give out, or I'm worried about a loved one over here, or I wonder what Boris is going to say tonight. Lots of things milling around in our minds. Let's just release those to the Lord and allow him to take them for the duration of this service and beyond. And now just turn your palms upwards on your laps, and just take this moment to set your intention to give your attention to the worship this morning. Whatever that means, you might be singing loud enough for us all to hear you right across Ellesmere Port. You may be just following the words of the songs on the screen. You may be praying quietly in your heart or out loud with those with you, or contributing to the worship on screen by adding your comments and keeping that attention on the worship so that the chat is reserved for that special time after the service, and what we put on the screen in the service encourages one another to keep that attention in worship. So we set our intention to give him our attention, knowing that he hears that and will honour that intention as we seek to stay with him and with one another through this service. So let's open our eyes now and say together the prayer of preparation. Having opened ourselves to the Lord, aligned ourselves with him, we invite him in to be at work in us and through us, even during this service. And so we say, Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom the secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. What better way to begin our worship and really get a sense of our God's greatness than by offering some thanksgivings? We had some lovely thank you pictures on the screen last week with some music, and we've had more come in. So thank you not just for the NHS, though very much for the NHS, but all sorts of thanksgivings that can flow together for us now. So enjoy this, enjoy the fresh pictures as well, and also do feel free to tap in your own thanksgivings onto the screen for anything and everything that you want to say thank you to God for over this week.
Give thanks to God for all his goodness, his love forever is the same. Give thanks to God, O holy nation, his love forever is the same. Thanks to God, O holy priesthood, his love forever is the same. Give thanks to God, O those who fear him, his love forever is the same. To God he heard me, he answered me and set me free. The Lord with me, no one can hurt me. He is my strength, my victory. Your confidence in princes, when enemies against me came,
God's strength provided my salvation. His love forever is the same. Thank you.
And so we move in from thanksgiving to praise. And we're going to begin with this prayer, which is based on Psalm 96. So please do join in with Julie and I as we say this prayer together.
Sing it out. Sing the Lord a new song. Sing it out. Sing out all the earth. Sing it out. Bless his name forever. Sing it out. For day by day he saves.
Tell every nation his glorious deeds,
every people his marvellous works. Praise him for praise his greatness deserves, his greatness above all gods. For the gods of the peoples are idols,
they're idle,
and nothing can come from their hands. But the Lord made the heavens, he reigns as our king, and in power and beauty he stands. So write it down, every nation, every people, write it down. God is glorious and strong. Write it down, for his name deserves all glory. Write it down. Bring him offerings and praise.
Then worship the Lord in his splendor and holiness,
and tremble before him, earth, and tell every nation, the Lord is king, justice firm as the earth he formed. And heavens be happy, rocks rejoice, seas shout, and sea creatures too. Fields wave and field mice join in the song as the forests find voice and sing. Then sing it out, for the Lord is coming. Sing it out, coming to judge the earth. Sing it out, his judgments will be righteous. Sing it out, his judgments will be true.
And so we continue to worship God in song as we sing the song, Blessed Be Your Name.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on a road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, Jesus. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name.
If you follow the Lectio 365 prayer slots in the morning online, there's a line that they sometimes say, one of those, which is that the Lord has loved us with all his heart, soul, mind and strength, which is absolutely mind-blowing. And I just find it very overwhelming every time I hear that. And it's in that context that the Lord calls us to love him back. For here our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen.
Amen. Lord, have mercy.
And so we call to mind those areas in thought, word and deed where we know that we have need for his cleansing and his forgiveness, confident that as we open ourselves to him, he will come in and do that work within us by his grace. And so we say, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been, help us to amend what we are, and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen.
Loving Christ, hanged on a tree yet risen in the morning, scatter the sin from our souls as the mist from the hills. Begin what we do. Inform what we say, redeem who we are. For in Christ we place our hope, our great hope, our living hope, this day and evermore. Amen.
And now we say together the collect for the day, the special prayer set for today, which is on your notices.
Risen Christ, your wounds declare your love for the world and the wonder of your risen life. Give us compassion and courage to risk ourselves for those we serve, to the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Now we're going to have our reading now, and this morning it's been brought to us by Susan Mayers.
This morning's reading is taken from Acts 7, beginning at verse 55. But Stephen, full of the Holy Spirit, gazed steadily upwards into heaven and saw the glory of God, and he saw Jesus standing in the place of honour at God's right hand. And he told them, Look, I see the heavens opened, and the Son of Man standing in the place of honour at God's right hand. Then they put their hands over their ears, and drowning out his voice with their shouts, they rushed at him. They dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. The official witnesses took off their coats and laid them at the feet of a young man named Saul. And as they stoned him, Stephen prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he fell to his knees, shouting, Lord, don't charge them with this sin. And with that, he died. This is the word of the Lord.
Last Friday was VE Day, the 75th anniversary of victory in Europe. When the government organised it, it was meant to be a day of national celebration. And indeed, there were celebrations happening. But with the virus and social distancing, It was all a bit subdued. The original celebration on the 8th of May 1945, however, was definitely not subdued. It was a tremendous outpouring of spontaneous joy and relief with the official ending of the war in Europe. People had street parties and danced and sang to the early hours. There was the sense that not only was the killing and the destruction of the war over, but now there was the chance to build something new. And part of what fueled that celebration was a shared desire for something better than the drab world of the 1930s. Surely all that suffering could not have been in vain. There was the sense that something new was going to emerge, that a new world was being born. And indeed, the United Nations and in our own country, the National Health Service and Universal Education all came with the ending of the war. Well, as did the gradual dismantling of the empire. Now, when I was thinking about our passage today, what struck me about the reading was that it's really about the vision that Stephen sees in the courtroom rather than about his martyrdom. And visions matter, because visions give us a glimpse of the future and what could be. Visions spur us on and give us direction and purpose. The book of Proverbs in the Old Testament tells us that where there is no vision, the people perish. And that just sums it up so well, because that's how important vision is. Certainly the vision that Stephen saw was what gave him the determination and the courage to stay true to his Lord and to embrace his death and to be a real witness. For witness is what the word martyr actually means. But let's set things in context. We first meet Stephen earlier on in the Acts of the Apostles when he's appointed one of the deacons. Now, the job of the deacons was to serve the people of the church and deal with food and money and so on, so that the apostles could devote themselves to their particular ministry. Now, presumably, Stephen did that. But he was also a fiery preacher, and he got into particular conflict with a synagogue of Greek-speaking Jews. Now, I speculate, but they may have been converts, because new converts are often more ardent than people raised in a faith. Anyway, Stephen gets hauled up before the high court, the Sanhedrin, and is accused of blasphemy. He makes his defence, but as far as the court is concerned, it's nothing of the sort. It's a full-on exposition of the Old Testament story of God calling and equipping his people, and indeed the people letting him down. And it ends with Stephen denouncing the nation for crucifying Jesus, the Messiah. It's all too much for his listeners, because by now the whole court is against him, especially when he breaks off to proclaim the vision that he's been given. "Look," he says, "I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing in the place of honour at God's right hand." So they put their hands over their ears so they can't hear, and shouting to drown out his voice, they rush at him and drag him off to be stoned to death. And the stones used weren't little pebbles, which is what stones might suggest to us. They were great boulders meant to crush and break his body. But even as he dies, he prays for his enemies, just as Jesus had done, as Jesus was being nailed to the cross. "Lord," says Stephen, "don't charge them with this sin." When he stood there in the courtroom, what Stephen saw was not so much of what might be as what actually is. Jesus is the ruler, the king, the Lord of the universe, almighty in power and majesty, with the full authority of God. Stephen sees the court of heaven, which is infinitely superior to the earthly court where he stands. and he realizes afresh that although he might be declared guilty by the lower court, that the court that really matters, the court of heaven, has declared him innocent. Indeed, not only is he declared innocent, he's also commended by Jesus himself. So did Stephen's vision die with him? Definitely not. In the short term, things looked bad for the infant church. A great persecution arose, and Christians were scattered all over Judea and Samaria. And Saul, a young man who had witnessed the whole thing, led the persecutions with a terrible zeal. But then, as a Christian theologian, Tertullian, was to say 100 or so years later, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. The scattered Christians actually took the gospel with them and spread the good news far and wide, so the church grew. Saul took to the persecution with a will, and he himself arrested and imprisoned many believers. But the events of that day must have stayed with him and made a deep impression, not least the joy and the faith that Stephen showed, even to the point of death. But perhaps above all, his vision. And then, on the road to Damascus, to hunt down Christians, Paul had a vision himself of Jesus and was utterly changed. From then on, his zeal would be for spreading the faith that he had once tried to destroy. Yes, visions are powerful things. What if we in the church were really able to catch Stephen's vision and to see how things really are, rather than getting bogged down in how they seem? His vision was of King Jesus ruling in majesty over the whole earth, so superior in power and glory to any earthly authority that nothing else really matters. Whatever possessions we might have or not have count for nothing. What the world might think of us counts for nothing. Nothing that humans can do to us matters. Indeed, nothing in this passing, transient world matters a jot compared to the wonderful privilege of knowing Jesus and being his servant. If we lived that out, it would turn not just the church, but our world upside down. But that is the reality that Stephen saw, and the reality that Saul wrote about later in his letter to the Philippians. King Jesus, ruling in majesty. When it comes to the coronavirus, we are a long way from the end. But people are already talking about what comes after and already thinking that there might be a new, better world. Perhaps like a lot of human plans, it will come to nothing. But at the very least, we need to pray that God will act in our world to bring real change. And that surely has to start with a real vision of what Jesus' kingdom might look like, with a fairer, better, cleaner world, where the powerful recognise their responsibilities rather than enforcing their rights, where the things of this world are shared rather than being grabbed by the strong, where disease and hunger and dirty water and poverty are things of the past, where people really matter, old and young, black and white, rich and poor. And that is a vision that could really inspire and could really change everything. Come, Lord Jesus. And so, let's pray. Heavenly Father, give power to your people and to your church. Help us to see what is possible when you are truly honoured and worshipped. Help us to hear your voice and to see your vision of a world transformed. Increase our faith and help us to dare to think that it is possible. As we live our lives for your kingdom in the power of the Holy Spirit, may your kingdom come, your will on earth be done as it is in heaven. That time when all people and nations shall be at peace, free from fear and want, at one with the planet, and knowing your love shown to us in Jesus our Lord, through whom we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Gordon. I don't know about you, but I found that stunning and wonderfully inspirational. Let's just take a moment. Gordon finished with prayer. Let's just stay in that place of prayer for a moment or two and be open to the vision that God might give us as a church, in families, as individuals, to be open and ready to see and hear and know what is going on behind what seems to be happening. So let's just take a moment and ask the Lord for his vision. Lord, as Gordon reminded us from the book of Proverbs, where there is no vision, the people perish. Lord, we want to live. We want to live in the light of your vision, of where you're taking us, of how you speak into the different situations of our lives, the challenging situations, and how you show us things that bring about change. Help us, Lord, to make space to see and hear from you. Even over these next few weeks, Lord, help us see, help us change. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to say our affirmation of faith now together. And I encourage you to, again, give this your full attention and to perhaps to adopt a posture that helps you say this with your full attention. You might want to take a stand on your faith. You might want to raise your hands in worship and praise as you state our faith together. You might want to have your hands open in trust. You might want to kneel. You might want to stay sat where you are, but just to bring yourself to a position of alertness and full engagement with the statement of faith that we're about to make together. So let's declare. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. And we're going to continue in our prayers now as Frank leads us in our intercessions.
In the power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray to the Father. Lord, help us to keep in mind your words. You are the light of the world, like a city on a hillside that cannot be hidden. Today, from our worldwide Anglican cycle of prayer, we're asked to pray for the church in Uganda and in South India, for Bishop Wilberforce of the Diocese of Namimberendi in Uganda, and for Bishop Egoni of the Diocese of Nandyal in South India. And here at home, the editor of our diocesan prayer cycle, Christopher Burkitt, has suggested this prayer for today. Most Holy God, build us as living stones into the spiritual house of our calling. May we know Christ as the cornerstone of all we attempt, so that our lives and our prayers become the very fabric of our Saviour's presence. We hold dear his promise that he has a place for each of us when we stray from the way that leads us there. Forgive us and restore us. And we pray for those whose discipleship is especially hard, the persecuted, the isolated, the misunderstood and the rejected. We pray for those carrying heavy burdens of care and responsibility in these troubling times, for those who feel near collapse, that they may find their strength renewed. We pray for all who are crushed by circumstances, the bereaved, the ill, the anxious, and all who have lost what they have built by years of effort and endeavour. And we pray for the best use of the guild buildings given into our care. Show us how we may be in ourselves signs of strength, holiness and continuity. When the things of place are restored to us, may we re-enter them conscious they are but stepping stones on the way that it is Christ. And so strengthen Keith, our bishop, and all your church in the service of Christ, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory to the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we renew our prayers for our troubled, distressed world, for enduring healing, health and peace. And especially we pray for those suffering because of the worldwide coronavirus, for all engaged in fighting this disease, for the leaders of all the nations. Give wisdom to all in authority. Bless Elizabeth our Queen and direct this nation and all the nations in the ways of justice and of peace, that all may honour one another and seek the common good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray now for our own community of Ellesmere Port, giving thanks for our celebrations on Friday for VE Day, remembering with gratitude those who served to confront and defeat the evils of the past. We give thanks for those who support our isolated friends, neighbours and families, for those who work in our local care homes, hospital and sheltered housing. Give grace to us, our families and friends, and to all our neighbours in Christ, that we may serve him in one another and love as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we now pause to lift to the Lord those presently on our minds, those who have particular needs. Jackie Wilson and her mother Doris. Comfort and heal all who suffer in body, mind or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We now remember those who have died recently. Tragically, rather more than usual. And so we lift to Almighty God, Robert Doak, Doreen Roberts, Douglas Rochelle, Debbie Lynn Wakefield, Stuart Huntrist, Constance Rodden, Ronald Sauberts, Tom Conde, Doreen Meadows, Norma Asprey, Paul Lambert, Eileen Willis, and John Henry Mountford. Let us recall too those that we have loved and lost a while. And Lord, we pray for all who are grieving. Hear us as remember now those who have died in faith, and according to your promises, grant us with them a share in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Keep us, good Lord, under the shadow of your mercy in this time of uncertainty and distress, and so rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Thomas, St. Lawrence, and of all your saints, we commend ourselves and the whole of creation to your unfailing love, as we join together in saying, Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And so can I encourage you to stand, if you're able, where you are, as we share in the peace. On the night of his resurrection, when his followers were locked together behind closed doors for fear of their enemies, Jesus came and stood in the midst of them and said, Peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us share with one another a sign of Christ's peace. Peace be with you. Peace. Our non-offertory hymn is one which encourages us to see our faith in terms of active service of the Lord in the world in which he has placed us, where we come across many obstacles and we always need his courage. So bring heaven to earth, Lord, and may we be the agents of your kingdom.
See restore the image. and all who gather here. As we are blessed and bless the world in peace.
And so we come now to our time of breaking bread and sharing wine. We begin with the words that you'll find on the service sheet. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is indeed right. It is right for us to thank him. It is right for us to give him praise. All that is spectacular, all that is plain, have their origin in Christ. All that is lovely, all who are loving, point to him as their fulfillment. And grateful as we are for the world we know and the universe beyond our understanding, we particularly praise you, living God, whom eternity cannot contain, for coming to earth and entering time in Jesus. For his life which informs our living, for his compassion which changes our hearts, for his clear speaking which contradicts our harmless generalities, for his disturbing presence, his innocent suffering, his fearless dying, his rising to life, breathing forgiveness. We praise you and worship him. And here too our gratitude rises for the promise of the Holy Spirit, who even now, confronts us with your claims and attracts us to your goodness. So what we do here and now, we do in imitation of what Christ first did. To his followers in every age, Jesus gave an example and command rooted in the experience he shared with his disciples in an upstairs room in Jerusalem. On the night he was betrayed, as they were sitting at a meal, Jesus took a piece of bread and broke it. He gave it to them, saying, "This is my body. It's broken for you. Do this to remember me." And after they'd eaten, he took a cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new relationship with God, the new covenant made possible because of my death. Drink this, all of you, to remember me." So we do what Jesus did. We take this bread and this wine wherever we are. It's the produce of the earth and the fruit of human labour, but in God's hands it becomes something different. For in these, Jesus has promised to be present, and through these, Christ can make us whole. So we join together in saying the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Every time we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father. Amen. So now we share bread and wine where we are. And as we do so, perhaps we just want to say to those around us, thank you for being you. And perhaps just express affection and maybe just affirm the importance of friends. Body of Christ, keep you to the last night.
Body of Christ, keep you. Amen. The blood of Christ keep you in everlasting life.
The blood of Christ keep you in everlasting life.
Amen.
We're coming towards the end of our service, and in a moment we're going to be having our final song, which is going to be slightly different this week. Stephen bore witness to the amazing victory of Christ and of his deity, and is seated at the right hand of God in heaven. And he died with words of forgiveness on his lips, just as Jesus did. He wanted to bless rather than to curse. And so as our final song, we're going to play the UK blessing, where Christians from all over this country, all different sorts of churches, have come together to make this song as a blessing on our nation, on our neighbours, on those who think we're weird, those who oppose us, those who ignore us. And although the words are quite simple, you may want to join in with them where you can. Let's use this as our own blessing of Ellesmere Port and Stoke, of our families, our friends, of those around us. Let's bless the country in which we live.
Amen. Amen. blessing. Manna rained down from heaven. This isn't second guessing. We know that we are protected. May the peace that surpasses all understanding be our message. Grace and favors in your nature, in your essence.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and your family, and your children,
and the children, and the children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations,
and
your family, and your children,
and the
children, and the
children.
Father, help us to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus, help us give ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. Holy Spirit, help us to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say. Amen. So our service comes to its end. Please do stay for coffee. We're going to be switching over to the coffee slide, as it were. Thank you for joining us in worship. And may God bless you and your children and everyone around you. Amen. Thank you.
like a dove and melts my heart with peace from above. Skies of blue, it takes my breath away, that you are here.
Folks, as that beautiful song fades away, we come to the end of our virtual coffee time. Do have a blessed day and a blessed week, and please do join us for prayer this evening at 7 o'clock. God bless.